So one other aspect of modern Italian politics is I've noticed is the rise of Euroscepticism. This is particularly surprising considering Italy could be argued to be one of the most truest of believers about the idea of a unified Europe. I mean, staunch support of the idea can be traced back to Mazzini, who envisioned a unified Europe under the leadership of a third Rome, which was later supported by Mussolini's Terza Roma, and later, the EU founding document being the Treaty of Rome. Craxi was pro-Europe as well, and it was very much going on even through Berlusconi. But I've noticed since the 2008 financial crisis, there's been one wave after the next of problems, such as the immigration influx, the EU overreach with deposing and appointing national leaders like Monti, and also the way they handled the lockdowns and COVID recently. I think we've seen a big increase of Italians questioning the reality of European integration and see is it worth it, considering after some one problem after the next, it seems to be Italy always taking the brunt of whatever problem arises. Could we see an eventual turnaround, or do you think Euroscepticism will be rising still in the future? I mean, ultimately, could we have a Italian exit, as we saw with Britain?
That's a very interesting question. Thanks, Daniel. Just you're very right to point out that, of course, Italy within the last 20 years has transformed itself from one of the staunchest, as you pointed out correctly, believers in the European project, so to speak, or European integration, call it as you may, into a largely Eurosceptic country. And you're also very right to point out the impact of the 2007-2008 global financial crisis, which here in Australia you tend to call the GFC. Australians have a love sometimes for acronyms. But of course, that of course a significant impact on the emergence, or if you like, not necessarily the emergence, but on the rise and the strengthening of different populist parties on the left and right side of politics. That's not surprise because populism, in a sense, thrives in periods and moments of significant economic and financial instability. Look, for instance, no further than the 20s and 30s. So I think when there's a major economic crisis, it's not surprising to, and there's, of course, significant economic hardship as a result, it's not surprising to see the emergence of parties that are unhappy with the current status quo. They're vocally anti-establishment. And that's what has happened in Italy and to Italy. But this phenomenon is not simply confined to Italy only. Of course, this problem was also compounded by the fact that to some extent, Italy's entry into the European Monetary Union, or to be more to use to be more to make it more simple, Italy embracing of the euro currency to some extent, while it had a number of advantages, it also imposed a significant straitjacket on Italy. And one way for Italy to prosper out of the new currency was to adopt a number of significant economic reforms, particularly liberalization of markets and so on and so forth, which Italy did. But to some extent, it's been a complex process. These reforms haven't oftentimes fully implemented. And so Italy has not been able to grow as much as before when the government could devalue the lira and therefore, if you like, regain competitivity by devaluing the lira. Once you adopt the euro, in a sense, there was, to make myself clear, before Italy, to some extent, has always been perhaps less competitive compared to Germany, because the cost of producing goods per unit are higher than in Germany due to higher inflation and so on and so forth. One way by which in the past Italian governments used to, if you like, close this gap and regain a degree of the ability to compete was by devaluing the lira, and therefore with a weaker currency, in a sense, you would be offsetting higher inflation. Now, with the euro, in a sense, that was no longer possible. So the only way was to reduce costs by improving productivity, or at least to improve it to a level to be on par with Germany. That's has not always been the case. That, of course, is if you can't rise productivity, the problem is that then you have to cut, you know, to cut jobs. You know, if you can't contain costs, or if you can't really reduce costs, then through greater profits and so on and so forth in terms of firms and so on and so forth, then what happens was that you have to cut jobs. So in a sense, the euro has been, in my view, has presented a significant challenge to Italian policymakers, but also to the wider system and also firms, workers, and so on and so forth. So you had, if you like, the combination of two problems. One, which was the fact that the euro was an opportunity, but also a challenge. At the end, has been seen as a challenge more than a new opportunity. And that's partly has been also Italy's fault, I would argue. And then on top of that, from 27, 28 onwards, you had the long effects of the global financial crisis, which has had also an impact on euro itself, because as it would be too long to explain why, but in a sense, that crisis also brought to the attention of international investors that the euro is a single currency, but that institutions behind the euro are still, and also, if you like, the financial and framework is not completely, is not streamlined. So for instance, to give you an example, Daniel, of course, Europe is not still a federal state. So while certain competencies lie with European institutions, others are still within the prerogative of nation states. So you have a common currency, but still, of course, national governments, they have their own fiscal policies. Of course, their abilities to run full independent fiscal policies has been significantly diminished. Their monetary policies are increasingly constrained, but nonetheless, it's difficult to harmonize a number of countries. And therefore, the bottom line was that, in a sense, what happens if one country, in this case, Italy, for instance, you know, if investors, given Italy, the fact that Italy has a high government debt, what if investors start losing faith in the system? Until the before the financial crisis, the assumption was that no matter what, the European Union would be able to, you know, there was no questions asked. Of course, with the euro, Germany will stand behind the euro. There won't be any run on a particular country or debt and so on and so forth. And then the financial crisis, and then the issues with Greece, and then investors fearing that actually Italy would not be able to repay the debt. And the fact that the Germans and others said, well, we are willing to help, but not to the point of covering Italian debts. And so to some extent has shown cracks in the armory, cracks in the euro framework. And so that has, that if you like, has also pushed the country to try to reduce its debt and so on and so forth. And of course, when you engage in significant spending cuts, then of course, in a sense, and people are asked to tie their belts more energetically, if you like, then of course the picture that you get, to cut a long story short, and I'm sorry for having been so long-winded on this particular question, then you have a fertile ground for the emergence of anti-establishment party. Now, to come to the last part of your questions, it's Italexic a possibility, meaning the Italian version of Brexit, journalists have called it Italexic. Is it possible? Look, I to be totally frank with you, the two parties that over the past few years really peddled the idea of Italexic, which was the Northern League, or League as nowadays it calls itself, and Brothers of Italy, for instance, and even to some extent the Five Star Movement on the left side of politics, well, all these voices have quietened down, even because during COVID, Italy has received significant loans and from the European Union. And so COVID has shown actually that the European Union willy-nilly, or like it or not, actually provides a safety net for a number of countries in time of need. And so, to be honest, I don't think there's any desire within any political party at the moment to actually pull Italy out of the European Union, which would be ruinous from my point of view in economic terms. But also there's no desire, and I don't think there's even, at the moment, it's not even discussed. I mean, Meloni was fairly Eurosceptic, and now actually she has very much toned down the rhetoric. And in fact, she's trying to work out a very, if you like, collaborative relationship with European institutions. So in the short, medium term, and even long term, no, I don't think that's a possibility. A different thing is if there's, let's say, international investors stop buying Italian bonds, then there's a risk of default. And then if there's a default, then the risk of an exit from the euro or if is a possibility, but at that point would be something imposed on Italy rather than Italy deciding to, if you like, pull the plug and get out. I don't know if I've been clear enough. I hope I was.
Very much so, but unfortunately, I think what you said is the same old story of the leaders of political parties, they or Italy itself, with being bailed out one way or another, they essentially get bought off. You know, it's all hellfire and brimstone on the way to government, and we're going to do this and we're going to do that. But then when the money comes in, then it's, oh, well, maybe it's not that bad. We'll reform, we'll talk. And then the fever kind of like dies down. I think it's bad. Do you think Europe, because Italy is basically one of the main pillars of the European Union, and as I said earlier, it's, you know, the Treaty of Rome was signed there, one of its constitution essentially. If Italy was ever to go, that would essentially be the end of the entire European project. I think as bad as Brexit was, it was still survivable. But if Italy goes, that's it. Do you think the European establishment will do basically anything it can to keep Italy in there, regardless if they should or they shouldn't?
Of course they would try to do that, but of course it depends if there's a default, then it's probably Italy probably would be have to abandon the euro currency, and of course there's the risk that to some extent the country would lessening its ties with European Union. You're right. I mean, in the sense that European Union might not be what it was, but it's also possible to imagine that a group of core countries would still hang in together. For instance, I find it very hard to see France and Germany splitting from each other, or even France, Holland, Belgium, Germany. Those countries have invested so much on the European project. Of course, without Italy would be a much diminished European Union, and perhaps there could be, realistically speaking, a certain element of disgregation. But it's feasible to imagine, it's possible to imagine actually a core of countries sticking together and in a sense, because really a full implosion of the European Union, I don't see it happening, because there's so many links binding several countries, and particularly the Western European core. There's so much political capital, economic capital, and not strictly in the economic sense, has been invested in creating these projects. And even if they wanted, it would be too difficult to completely untangle themselves from it. So it's various permutations, various scenarios are possible, but still it's very possible, in fact, indeed, very likely to imagine that a core of European nations would still underpin the European Union, in my view. Whether the European Union will be symbolically and politically less influential, that's quite possible, as you foreshadowing, but I don't think that an Italian exit would really spell the end of the European Union in general. Perhaps as we know it would be diminished, if you like, a smaller or less influential European Union. But I don't see the Union completely imploding and disappearing from Earth, really, if I could put it that way.
Well, that kind of touch upon my next question in talking about Europe and the spread of the anti-establishment, predominantly Eurosceptic parties right throughout the continent. I mean, we had the rise of Le Pen in France. We had the 2015 Greek referendum, which rejected the EU bailout, and the rise of the once Eurosceptic party, Syriza. We had the AfD in Germany rise up. We have so much discontent going on, even now. Even in very much very pro-European EU countries, such as the Netherlands, we've seen a rising Euroscepticism within its minor parties as well, making some headway in the recent elections, such as the Forum of Democracy and JA21. Do you see it further increasing across Europe, or do you touch upon it already, but more on a European level, not just Italian? Do you think this is going to continue, and is it possible for the EU to collapse within the next 10 to 20 years?
That's a very interesting question, and it's difficult for me to really see far ahead. I mean, if I were to, the risk of projecting. I always teach my students how to think. You know, sometimes look into. The crystal ball and try to imagine the future and to try to understand where the international system or even a region could possibly go in 10 or 20 years down the line. And the way in which sometimes we reach conclusions, which is to say, well, it's not far-fetched to assume, or it's possible to assume, or perhaps we run the risk that so-and-so would possibly happen. Of course, all these hypotheses are based on current trends, on current situations. But of course, current trends and the current status quo, while it might be an indication of things to come, it's not certainty. On the other hand, these things would eventually materialize. And so, if we were to assume that in the major countries you have populist governments in power, would that spell the end of the European Union? I mean, my guess is to say to you, no, it won't do that, because in fact, in my view, and Italian experience is showing it now, but even before, during the previous green yellow government majority comprising the League, whose color is the green, and the Five Star Movement, whose color was the yellow, even under that sort of populist how to put it, hybrid, because of course there were two parties of populist. You could call them populists, but then, if you like, putting forward different proposals and different programs. But even they came to power saying, well, the European Union and so on and so forth, and lambasting the European Union, criticizing it. But in reality, when the punch came to shove, they actually follow pretty much a straight line of fiscal, if you like, rectitude, if I could put it that way, which pleased Brussels. And Meloni is doing very much the same. So are these politicians, if you like, I think what has happened is that once you come to power, you realize actually what it is to govern. And also you realize the strong bonds that economic, nowadays social, political, cultural, that links Europe. I mean, if you look, for instance, at the current Polish government, you could call it fairly Eurosceptic. Doesn't particularly regard Brussels as, but nonetheless, the Poles, as they've always been doing over the past 20 years, they're very much willing to take and not very willing to give. And they are quite critical of Brussels, but would they leave the European Union? I don't think so. Would a France with Le Pen as a president would want to leave Europe, the European Union? I don't think so. What could realistically happen is that perhaps there could be tension within the system. There would be, if you like, a rebalancing within the European Union, which is, to some extent, nation states would try to claw back powers from the Brussels bureaucracy. And to some extent, there would be a more intergovernmental system of government, which is, well, the major decisions are taken by the Council of Ministers and not necessarily by the Commission. But even then, that's what the situation is in at the moment within the European institutional framework. The balance has always been very much in favor of the Council of Ministers, so of nation states deciding what to do. The Commission can only propose and then implement. And so even if to some extent nation states will become more vocal and more critical of the European Commission, I still think the European Union would exist. But it's possible they would exist in a different configuration, with a core of still closely knit nation states, and then a more of Europe à la carte, if you like, with a core of still very integrated nations, and then perhaps a group of more loosely linked nation, and that's possible, but I don't think that the whole political construct would disappear in 20 years time, even under significant political stress.
So you're basically saying if multiple countries manage to gain a Eurosceptic populist government at the same time, you can see the European Union reforming itself into a loose decentralized union of nation states, as opposed to what it is now, which is more the centralization and federalization away from the national sovereignty to this overarching entity.
There could be a pullback in terms of certain policies. There could be no appetite for further integration. There could be, to some extent, again, a major influence of nation states within the Council of Ministers saying, well, we don't want to do this or we don't want to do that. We don't want to... So it could take different forms and shape, but in reality, it's already even nowadays, to some extent, if you think the picture is quite complex, there's growing integration, in fact, and then there's stalling in certain areas, because of course, really ensuring that 27 countries move on the same pace, it's quite difficult. But look, on the other hand, COVID has been has actually acted as if you like, as acted as actually emphasized the need of more integration in certain areas, and that has taken place. But also, if you look at Russia's invasion of Ukraine and the response by the European Union, I think overall the response has been actually quite robust. And despite the fact that you had 27 countries, but nonetheless, several rounds of sanctions have been taken against Russia, and significant sanctions, sending arms and weapons to Ukraine through Poland. Of course, you could argue that more could be done, and but nonetheless, in only the past 12 months, European governments have taken, within the European Union, have taken decisions that they would have never taken before. They've taken them fairly quickly, with very minimal disagreement, and that was no mean feat. So, in a sense, even you would argue, just even the current Italian government, you could certainly describe it as populist in a sense. But in reality, on a number of issues, has been firmly in favor of, for instance, of Ukraine, has worked closely with the European institutions. So, I think when significant problems arises, then those problems do focus policymakers' attention. And then there's little time for like for politicking and playing party politics. And in reality, then you have to make tough decisions. And look, I of course, depending on where one position itself in political terms, but I've been a fairly, I thought the overall European project has been a positive force for peace and stability in Europe. It hasn't been perfect, but overall it has, in my view, has been very positive. And it's when, even in the past 10 years, if you look at the past 10 years, there's been significant stress in the system, there's been significant squabbling, but then on key issues, actually there's been way more unity than disunity. And even parties that came into power by, if you like, waving the anti-Brussels flag, if I could put it that way, then when they came to power, actually they toned down the rhetoric. One, because they realized that it's easier to say things once you're in opposition, it's more difficult to govern. And also because you govern within a European framework, so there are also limitations to what you can do. But more to the point is the realization has always been the case that actually European problems are best resolved by if you like, solidarity more than fracturing and squabbling. So I'm relatively positive that even under pressure if France would have a populist president, then I'm sure that France rhetoric could become possibly, or Le Pen rhetoric could be, of course, strident. But to what extent that would push the system to implode, I'm not so sure. Actually, I would still remain moderately positive that no such a thing would actually happen.